Charles M. Kinney, or as some in earlier years pronounced it, Kinney, was born a slave in Richmond, Virginia in 1855. After the Civil War, he spent several years gaining an education and learning the trade of barbering. As a young man, Charles joined a wagon train of freedmen and worked his way to the mining town of Reno, Nevada. It was here, during a series of lectures by J. Ann Loughborough and Ellen G. White in 1878, that he was converted.
"And now, my dear Brother Kinney, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen."
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, you seven are the first fruits in Nevada. If you're faithful in service, this new Reno church will grow.
We'll be faithful, Elder Loughborough. But what do we do now?
First, you need to choose officers. Well, you won't have a pastor right away, but you should elect an elder. And a church clerk is absolutely necessary. You should choose someone who'll keep careful, accurate records.
In that case, I nominate Brother Kinney here for clerk. No one could do a better job.
I second the motion.
Does everyone agree?
Aye.
Fine. Brother Kinney, your responsibilities will include sending quarterly reports to the conference.
At that time, the California Conference administered the work in Nevada. Conference officials were so impressed with Charles's work that they soon made him secretary of the Nevada Tract and Missionary Society. Charles set about his new duties with the same earnest determination that characterized all his work. A few years later, his fellow church members devised a way to help him further develop his talents and usefulness.
"Brother Kinney, we are more than pleased that you've succeeded in placing a complete collection of SDA books in the Reno Public Library and one in the Temperance Reform Club."
"Well, I love to share my faith in every way I can, Elder. In fact, I've been writing to some of my friends in Virginia and sending them the signs of the times. I'm happy to say they're beginning to express an interest in the third angel's message."
"That's wonderful."
"I'm sure the Lord will bless your efforts, Brother Kinney. You show a real talent for writing and debating."
"Oh, thank you, brother.
That's why we wanted to meet with you today. The officers of the California Conference agree with us that your talent and zeal should be encouraged."
"In what way?"
"The conference has agreed to help us pay your way to the new college in Healdsburg."
"College? But I have so little schooling. I'm too old for..."
"As my mother used to say, you'll never learn any younger. Will you go, brother?"
"Oh, yes. Oh, yes, I surely will."
So, in 1883, the year that Germany introduced a strange new concept called sickness insurance, Charles went to college. Ellen White lived in Healdsburg at this time, and he undoubtedly heard her speak occasionally during his 2 years there. In 1885, the conference sent him to Topeka, Kansas, to start a work among the African American population there. His reports to the Review and Herald were eagerly read by believers.
"Say, Nettie, here's the latest report from Brother Kinney out in Kansas."
"What they have to say, Joe? I hope his work's going well. He labors so hard.
Oh, why, yes.
From June to mid-October, he canvassed a third of the colored homes in Topeka."
"And there are a lot of homes to cover. Thousands of freedmen are coming up from the South to Kansas. Most of them settle in Topeka and Emporia because they can go to college there.
And now, thanks to Brother Kinney, they also have the opportunity to hear of the third angel's message. He had 3 converts last October."
"Mm-hmm."
"Are there any more now?"
"Well, only 2 more. Women in Emporia. No men have accepted the message yet, but a couple are very interested. Since he arrived there, he's made 648 visits and distributed 16,525 tracts."
"Oh, what a hard worker he
oh,
is.
Oh, yes.
How does he do it all, I wonder?"
"How do you do it all, Brother Kinney? Every morning I see you trudging up and down the streets, door to door."
"That's exactly how I do it, Sister Jackson. In the mornings I canvass with the great controversy. In the afternoons, I give Bible studies, and I hold evangelistic meetings in the evenings.
From Topeka, Charles moved on to Kansas City in Atchison, Kansas, and St. Joseph in Hannibal, Missouri. His converts were welcomed into the white congregations. It was in 1889, while working in St. Louis, that Charles first encountered racial prejudice in the Adventist Church. He deplored the situation in letters to Elder D.T. Jones, secretary of the General Conference. Elder Jones, a Missourian of Charles's own age, did his best to encourage the young preacher. After 6 months in St. Louis, Charles moved on to Louisville, Kentucky. It was high time for his work to receive official recognition. On October 5th, 1889, at the camp meeting in Nashville, Tennessee, Elder R.M. Kilgore, leader of the Southern District, officiated in a special ceremony.
It is my privilege today to ordain Brother Charles Kinney as a minister of the gospel. Elder Kinney is the first ordained minister of his race, and this ordination sets him aside to the work of the ministry.
Amen.
I think we should take some time at this workers' meeting to discuss the racial problem we've encountered. Many people have stayed away from the camp meeting because colored believers are present. I propose that we have a separate section in the meetings where our colored brethren may sit. What do you think, Brother Kinney?
With all due respect, Brother Kilgore, that proposal is one of great embarrassment and humiliation. I want to make sure my converts will not be driven from the truth by such a position.
Well, what do you suggest, then?
I believe that the Advent message can remove all prejudice. But for now, perhaps as soon as there are enough converts, we should form colored conferences which will bear the same relation to the general conference that white conferences do.
In 1890, Elder Kilgore led out in a resolution of the General Conference Committee to establish segregated churches. The same year, Ellen White visited St. Louis and observed firsthand the racial prejudice there. That year also, Charles organized the Louisville Church, the second church of African American people in the denomination. At the 1891 General Conference session, Ellen vigorously protested both prejudice and the segregation policy.
I know that which I now speak will bring me into conflict, but I do not mean to live a coward. It has become fashionable to look down upon the poor and upon the colored race in particular. But Jesus was poor. And he declares that every insult shown to them is as if shown to himself. While at St. Louis a year ago, these words were presented to me as with fire. All ye are brethren.
Well, what is she saying anyway?
The colored people should have just as much respect as any of God's children. Those who have despised them have despised the purchase of the blood of Christ and need the transforming grace of Christ in their own hearts. We should be careful not to strengthen prejudices that ought to have died as soon as Christ redeemed the soul from the bondage of sin.
In later years, because of the dangers to church members resulting from racial hatred in the country, Ellen agreed to a temporary policy of segregated churches, but added that in time the Lord would show the church a better way. Charles Kinney also addressed the 1891 General Conference session, where he pleaded passionately for more resources to be invested in the work for African Americans.
I earnestly pray that the conference shall delegate a white laborer to the work among this people, giving his whole time in taking the truth to them, developing their talents, educating, and getting them into the work.
Brother Kinney, I was very impressed with your appeal today.
Does that mean we'll get the help we need?
Oh, I'm afraid not. Unfortunately, the consensus of the General Conference Committee is that your request is impractical.
The situation is impossible. Now that Brother Barry has gone to Canada, I'm the only ordained colored minister in the country. I can't do it all alone. I must have help.
You will have help. I know you will.
But when, brother? When?
Charles pressed on, blazing trails in spite of prejudice, ill health, and the hostility of ministers of other denominations. His prayer for help was eventually answered in 1894 when Edson White entered the southern field with his riverboat, the Morning Star. That same year, Charles organized his fifth church in Nashville, Tennessee. While in Nashville, Charles finally married. His wife became an invalid, however, and her illness led him to retire in 1911. Though plagued with illness himself, Charles lived to the age of 96. He died August 3, 1951, at the Riverside Sanitarium in Nashville. During his long life, he had seen the African American membership in the United States grow from a mere handful to more than 26,000. This growth owed an immeasurable debt to the labors of Charles Kinney, the pioneer of African American Adventism.